B.5 Club 4444 Life. Welcome. It's time to play the podcast.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Wrestling Defenders, presented by the B.5 Club. It's been longer than a while.
It's been more than a hot minute. It's been like a hot week.
It's been a hot week. When was the last time we recorded? I think I checked, it was November.
It was Hell in the Cell.
It was Hell in the Cell was our last pay-per-view that we had recorded for. And even then, I took like a week to upload that one.
Yeah, seriously, because WWE with this new pay-per-view system, again, kicking our asses, and so is school. School's just being a bitch right now.
Especially the MCP semester, which is mixed class productions, which is just you get a bunch of kids from a bunch of different classes and then you just have them make a movie for 13 hours.
And half of them don't know what they're doing, and it's fine because I'm included in that in some regard.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm taking 5 MCP classes and I'm like, I don't know how to do any of this shit. Like, what's production design?
I want to die.
I absolutely want to die. I make that a point. I tell every professor, listen, I want to die.
This semester, I'm definitely going to want to die. Yeah. I'm just letting you know. But Alex, before we get started, I want to say something real quick. You and I, we got 3 screens going on right now,
We got 3 screens going on
right
now.
We got 2 mics.
We finally got 2 mics.
2 mics, so now you won't have to hear me like awkwardly leaning back in my chair for him to talk.
Yeah, no, that's the fantastic thing about it. And I've been telling everyone, like, I got new mics. I want to do everything with these mics. I've been fucking around
everything,
with these mics.
Everything with these 2 mics. So, dude, I remember us recording this podcast in your living room.
Yep.
Just sitting there, and your annoying-ass neighbor's making fucking noise.
Yep.
And you can hear the click of me playing video games over talking, like, all the gameplay we had. And now look at us. We got 2 mics. What a year's different makes.
This is the official, unofficial year, because our first ever, like, consistent podcast we did was the Royal Rumble 2016.
In 2016. That was 2017.
Yep, and the more things change, the more they stay the same.
Yes. So, Alex, it's been a pleasure doing this podcast with you for a year and many more to come.
Yep, shake hands.
Oh, there, yeah.
Too sweet me?
Too sweet. Oh, yeah.
There we go.
We're so cool, yeah, yeah.
We're so cool, yeah, yeah. So, as you can probably guess, this is the 2017 edition of the Royal Rumble. Coming to us live from the Alamo Dome in San Antonio, Texas. They should never fucking do a Royal Rumble in this fucking building
again.
God,
no, it's like running a marathon to the fucking ring.
No, because I had like a little get-together party thing for that, and our friend Jose was like, oh man, this building, like, it looks cool because it's really big, and you know. The number they said was like 52,000 people, but it's probably like 48,000. They bumped those up,
yeah.
You know. And it's cool to look at, but that fucking ramp, it was like WrestleMania 24.
Seriously. And then also, like, so I went to San Antonio over the Christmas break, driving back home. And I remember my hotel was kind of near the Alamo Dome, so I went to go check it out. And goddamn, that building is huge.
Yeah, and I think they added the cutoff a certain point. Because I remember I was, we'll get to it in a bit, but in the Royal Rumble, when Bray Wyatt came out, that, you know, the lights are off, the fireflies are out and about, and then
he just ended up at the ring.
Yeah, and then they pan up, and like there's just a section where it's just the fireflies just cut off,
mm-hmm.
And it's really fucking funny. So I think they had to cut out like half the fucking arena.
Actually, no, it's funny because I was looking online, and they had buggies for like people like Big E, Mark Henry, Big Show to like hurry them down to the ring.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody made a meme of Big E on that cart as if he was in Mario Kart.
Yeah,
best fucking thing I've ever seen.
If I can find that, I'll post it on the Twitter. Of which you can go to see our live reactions and thoughts.
Ooh.
For NXT TakeOver.
Yes.
So, also, I want to get out of the way. We have a Patreon now.
We do, yes.
At B.5 Game, you can check us out on Patreon. You get rewards for, you know, donating a certain amount of money, you know, being a patron. For $1, you get an on-screen shout-out, which is pretty cool. $5, you can get an associate producer credit for all of our short films that we plan on doing.
Yes.
And for $10 to $15, we still haven't decided. We're thinking of making, because we have a lovely artist who's going to be doing some art for the channel. And we're going to make some, I guess, you know, little necklaces out of those, little pendums.
Yeah, little necklaces, little pendums.
So you can get those if you donate $10 to $15. And for $25, you get a t-shirt.
A B.5 Club shirt. You can be a part of the B.5 Club. And let me tell you, it's a very exclusive group.
It's a very exclusive group. Honestly, there's probably like 3 of us official.
Yeah, official. Everyone else just kind of hangs around sometimes.
Yeah, they're moochers.
Yeah.
They're just vultures hanging off our popularity.
And then they try to two-sweet us. And then we're just like, you're not so cool, yeah, yeah.
You're not so cool, yeah. And then I put their hands out like, no.
even my girlfriend would do that to her too. I'm like, no, sweetie, no, you don't know. You just don't know.
So I'm really excited for that. That's going to be really a lot of fun. I would really appreciate it if you guys can go and donate. We're also on Twitch now, so if you want to see some gameplay live, you know, that can be really fun to come hang out with us.
Yeah, maybe see Xander play some Outlast. Maybe see me suck at WWE 2K.
Yeah, have you played 2K17 yet?
I don't own it.
All right, well, we can get into that sometime.
Because, dude, I'm out here trying to get tattoo work done. I'm out here trying to pay rent.
Yeah.
I'm trying to basically look like Baron Corbin, but without the long hair.
Oh, Baron Corbin. So get the long hair. Just do it. Just fucking get the long hair.
I don't have patience.
Yeah, I didn't either, man, but once I got into the swing of things, hey man, the chicks dig it.
Maybe.
A few of them dug it so far.
Oh, yeah.
So I kind of think we should get into this Rumble, I guess.
Hashtag forget the Rumble.
Forget the Rumble. Jeez. So this match, the first match to kick off the show was Charlotte and Bayley for the Raw Women's Championship. We were late for this one.
Yeah, I mean, it was fine. It's a match that I know they can put on, but it wasn't the best match I think they could have put on. But then again, you don't want your best match to be at the Rumble anymore, I think.
No, and what's... Because like I said, we missed the first half, so I had to go back and rewatch it. It was really sloppy in the beginning. They're fucking up a lot of, you know, spots.
I mean, I love Bayley, but she kind of works a little sloppy in the ring sometimes.
And also Charlotte, when she got to the main roster, she was working a little sloppy. And okay, so I was rewatching it, and I got the same value of rewatching as it was the first time, because you know Bayley's not going to win this one.
Yeah, of course, they're saving it for Mania.
Yeah, they're going to save that for Mania. And I had this theory of, okay, they kept bringing up that Bayley has two wins over Charlotte, right? Mm-hmm. And then Charlotte now has one win over Bayley, I believe, right?
Yes.
And then they're going to have a rematch at Fastlane, and so they're 2-2. So to break the, you know, the tie, they have the match at Mania where Bayley wins.
See, here's my whole thing with that. Is that I agree the Charlotte and Bayley feud should be what is going into WrestleMania, but at the same time, I don't know about giving it again on Fastlane. I mean, Fastlane is just going to be a setup for Mania, just like Elimination Chamber is going to be a setup for Mania, and I understand it, I do, I just, like, I don't understand why I keep giving me so much of a good thing. It's like, hey, I like cheeseburgers, but I'm not going to have cheeseburgers every night of the week. I don't want to see Bayley versus Charlotte on every pay-per-view. And I don't want to see, like, Sasha and Charlotte on every pay-per-view.
No, do they have, is she still with Dana Brooke, Charlotte? Is that still a partnership?
I have no fucking idea. This is like a bad relationship to where they're like, are they still together? I hope they're not, but you know, yeah. I can never be that sure.
Well, I mean, I don't want Bayley versus Dana Brooke again. Because remember that they were feeding her to Dana, or feeding Dana Brooke to Bayley until she got the Charlotte.
By the way, Dana Brooke, Jesus Christ, those guns.
Yeah, holy shit, she is fucking ripped. But do you think they're going to do another three-way? We're replacing Becky with Bayley? Because I remember on Monday...
With Sasha as well in the mix?
Yeah, it's going to be Sasha, Bayley, and Charlotte.
I've heard rumbles of a four-way between Nia Jax, Charlotte, Sasha, and Bayley.
Is Nia really up to the caliber of Mania Fatal 4 for the title?
Nia's basically the female Braun Strowman at this point.
Well, difference is I like Braun Strowman a lot.
Yeah, I mean... You can get over Braun Strowman. But then again, I know you and I both hated him at the start.
At the start, yeah. I mean, unless Nia Jax can suplex a tree.
It's one of those things where like she's just been booked to be this strong.
Well, that, and I don't care anymore, because remember Bayley tapped her out at... What was it, the NXT show a while back when they fought?
Actually, no, she didn't tap out. She just passed out.
Oh, she passed out. But she did tap out at Survivor Series.
Yeah, that is true.
They tapped her out there, and I'm like, well, is she really a monster, or is she just there?
True. They've got to book her better than just, like, she's a monster. She's basically Braun Strowman without the beard and the penis.
Or maybe. I don't know, dude.
Who knows?
So then, well, anyway, Charlotte won with the natural selection on the hardest part of the ring, the apron.
Of course.
The hardest part of the arena.
The hardest part of the world.
Yeah, and then she gets a clean win, 1-2-3, so.
You know, rumors say that the side of the ring cuts diamonds.
I've heard that. Yes. I think that's how Kay Jewelers goes every year to the WWE Performance Center, and just to chip away. They just chip away. And then Kevin Owens versus with Chris Jericho in a shark cage versus Roman Reigns for the WWE Universal title. Let me get this out of the way first. The shark cage gimmick was weird the first time I saw it with Paul Ellering earlier.
At a TakeOver?
Yeah, TakeOver. And then it was weird here anyway because I'm still expecting them to like climb the ladder and retrieve Chris Jericho to win the match. You know? And okay, the shark cage gimmick is kind of dumb anyway, but then...
I can just imagine, like, Kevin Owens running in with Chris Jericho over his shoulder, handing him to the ref. Like, yeah. Let's do this!
You cash in Chris Jericho. The shark cage gimmick was really dumb, and then added the fact that it was they just randomly made it no DQ.
Yeah, I mean, I like the no DQ, because I feel like it's a good end into it. Because I wasn't a big fan of the Kevin Owens... Reigns feud. I mean, this match proved me wrong in some regard. It proves to me that Kevin Owens is the strongest and hardest working man on this roster. Here's why. He literally builds a tower out of chairs and then proceeds to put himself through it. He then does a frog splash with Roman through a table. I mean... That, in and of itself, should prove how hard this man's going to work for you in a match.
True. I think in kayfabe, I think Kevin Owens should just stop building stuff, because he's going to go through it.
Oh, yeah, definitely. He always ends up going through stuff he builds.
I think he had a match with Dean Ambrose, I think, at the Royal Rumble last year.
Yeah, actually, it was Rumble last year to where he set up two tables.
Yeah, two tables, he went through them, and then he came out anyway like a champ. And so... Anyway, so the whole shark cage thing was, okay, so Jericho can't interfere, but everyone's thinking, oh, he's going to find some way to, oh, he's going to drop something from the cage. And
he did.
And he did. But the power of him dropping those brass knuckles was kind of faded when throughout the whole match, they started the match with them brawling into the crowd and then beating the shit out of each other with chairs and tables.
Yeah, I feel like that's a little premature to start off your match by like, fuck it, we're going into the crowd. Like, that should be like a building point.
Yeah, and it killed the gimmick of the brass knuckles, of which Roman Reigns kicked out of anyway. So Kevin Owens, Superman punches Roman Reigns with the brass knuckles, and he kicks out anyway, which prompted X-Pac on Twitter. you pissed off,
you know,
X-Pac.
X-Pac is the goddamn final word on WWE today.
I suppose, but he was like, really, did he kick out of brass knuckles? I figure William Regal was... I think Jose said something about William Regal. Him being upset about it. I don't think William Regal would, to be honest. I think that was more William Regal's thing, so...
I think it's funny how Kevin's pulled out a stunner, and then Stone Cold was like, come on, kid, you gotta put a little stank on it.
Yeah. I fucking love that stunner spot.
Oh, yeah, that stunner spot was great. The brass knuckle spot was great. But I hated how Braun had to interfere at the end.
Well, okay, so... So leading up to that, we had Roman Reigns make a comeback. He put Kevin Owens through a table... And then he's going to go do a thing, maybe a spear. And then through the crowd, Braun Strowman comes out, and he slams him, puts him through a table, and then he does another power slam through a table in the ring. And then Owens gets the pin. And they did nothing with that later that night.
Yeah.
But I know they're building up to Fastlane so they can kind of go through him to get to Taker, which kind of sucks.
Yeah,
I mean, you're building up all that guy for Roman Reigns.
Yeah, honestly, I don't understand why they had a change of heart between Cena and Reigns. I don't understand that at all.
No, because in Vince's eyes, it's like, you want to get a guy over, make him fight a giant. But my thing was, like, they tried that last year with Big Show, or 2 years ago with Big Show, and it didn't work then. And it's not going to work now.
No, because people just don't want to see anymore big guy fight big guy. I mean, sometimes it's nice to have... i.e. a Mark Henry versus Big Show, or a Brock Lesnar versus The Great Khali, or something like that. But it's so oversaturated at this point. It's kind of like hearing your friends say, like, oh man, I just picked up the new iPhone 4. Like, that's awesome, dude, but there's, like, so much better versions of that.
Yeah. It's a funny tidbit, when Braun Strowman came out to interfere, Michael Cole says, who the hell? Who on this entire fucking roster looks like Braun Strowman?
Big Show if he became homeless.
So Big Show.
Yeah, Big Show. No, but yeah, seriously. And also to where it's been the same five guys working your main events on your brand. Mm-hmm. Who else is coming out?
Well, now they have the Samoa Joe thing happening. Of which everyone's getting pissed off that he wore a suit. Why
that Samoa Joe wore a suit?
Yeah, why is everyone all pissy about that?
I mean, that's fine by me. I mean, he's Triple H's stooge, and Triple H is not like the suit-wearing guy. I mean, to me, it fits. Because Seth Rollins wore suits all the time whenever he was a part of the Authority.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see an issue with it.
I don't. Wasn't he in the Main Event Mafia, or did he fight the Main Event Mafia?
He was in the Main Event Mafia.
Okay, I was just making sure. But fucking, really? Like, it's a fucking suit. Did you want him to come out like fucking Umaga or Kamala, start banging his belly or
some
shit?
I want him to come out like he did in TNA with like the weird face paint that was supposed to be a tattoo and the mohawk.
Yeah. Oh, God. Where he weighed like 100 pounds more.
Triggered.
So Kevin Owens won. He retrieved Chris Jericho from the shark cage to later cash him in at WrestleMania.
Of course.
And then, you want to talk about this chicken fucking commercial?
This chicken fucking commercial. All right. Enzo Amore, I understand. You are basically the Italian Ric Flair. I get it. But why the hell did you sign up for a commercial to where it's implied that you fuck a bucket of chicken?
I don't think they thought about that.
No, they didn't.
Because when you... Let's break it down for a second. So, Big Cass comes in. He goes, Enzo, you're all dressed up. What you wearing? Because he's wearing some Southern gear.
Exactly, like some Colonel Sanders shit.
Yeah, he's wearing some Colonel Sanders shit. And he says he has a hot date with some Southern belle named Georgia. And then we pan to a bucket of chicken, which is the new Georgia Gold. And I'm making fun of KFC for this. While we're eating KFC.
Yeah, while we're literally shoveling their fried chicken into our mouths.
So I guess it worked. Anyway.
I mean, but it wasn't that Georgia Gold.
So, no, I don't think I'm ever going to want that Georgia Gold. It looks a little weird.
Oh, God. I just thought of a horrible image of, like, a Georgia Gold chicken breast and cutting a hole in it. And no.
Oh, fuck. I was really concerned, like, we were going to cut away from that and then come back. And it was like an American Pie thing where he's just fucking that bucket of chicken. Okay, so Enzo Amore is fucking a chicken, which is a bestiality.
Mm-hmm.
The chicken is cut up and chopped, so it is dead.
So it's necrophilia.
It's necrophilia, bestiality.
Yes.
And he's role-playing as a colonel. So he's in the role-playing, bestiality, and necrophilia all at once when you imply that he's playing the colonel trying to fuck a bucket of chicken.
Hmm.
I mean, the New Day had a commercial for voodoo, but they weren't trying to fuck the television set. I mean, just, I enjoy chicken, that is it. That's all you fucking have to do. You don't have to fuck the chicken, dude.
Just how sad is it to where they're like, I can just imagine that board meeting. Vince goes, Enzo, I got the best thing to put you over. Oh boy, Mr. McMahon, what's it gonna be? This is what's going to happen. We got this new brand deal with KFC. Oh boy, like, am I going to be feuding with Dolph Ziggler because he pretended to be the colonel? No. See this bucket of chicken? Yeah. How sexually attracted to it are you? What? How attracted to the chicken are you? It's a bucket of chicken, boss. I know. Listen. Well, I'm just going to leave you and the chicken here alone. See if you guys like each other. Here's a six-pack. Here's, you know, some Jack Daniels Take the Edge Off. And also here's some Barry White. Roll the camera.
So, I'm like, you're going to fuck this bucket of chicken.
You're going to fuck it because I tell you to fuck it.
Which was worse, the Dolph Ziggler Miz thing or this?
Honestly, the Dolph Ziggler Miz thing.
Probably because those two were... One of them was an IC champion, and the other was a contender.
Also, not two wrestlers were ruined by this, but just Enzo Amore. Big Cass just kind of left before anything got too bad.
No, dude, I rewatched it like earlier. He didn't leave. He stayed until the whole commercial, and he said, aren't you going to introduce me? Which implies he is also...
They're going to have a three-way with that bucket of chicken!
He is gonna face-fuck that bucket of chicken... I think it's because Enzo Amore is like, he's just trying to, is that his character? He's trying to get laid all the fucking time? Because didn't he try to fuck Lana a month ago?
Yeah, but then again, he's the Italian stallion.
I suppose. I fucking suppose.
Have you ever met an Italian?
Yeah, I mean.
How horny were they?
Well, not towards me, but exactly. Just like in general, I guess.
Exactly, just because they weren't horny towards you doesn't mean they weren't horny.
I suppose, man. And then moving on, we had Foley and Steph backstage talking about how the cage was ineffective. And that's your own fucking fault because you're dumb.
Yeah, dumbass.
And then Shane McMahon and Daniel Bryan came in and they're talking about the Rumble or whatever. And then fucking Sami Zayn walks in. And he hasn't picked his number yet, I guess. The Rumble is like in what, like
an hour.
It's in an hour, and all the participants have not picked up their fucking numbers?
Because reasons. And then Dean Ambrose comes out talking about he needs some churros.
You hear their churros about. Which I actually was thinking about, like, I haven't had a churro in a while. I think if I would have heard churros, I would have fucking looked for it.
But one thing I don't understand, why is Sami Zayn being booked at this, like, loser geek?
From what I'm hearing is during the UK tournament, somebody did a Blue Thunder Bomb, and then he sent out a tweet saying that they had copied him or whatever, and then Tyson Kidd tweeted at him talking about all the moves that he had stolen. And so I think they're kind of pissed at Sammy for a little bit. So they're just going to make him eat shit for a little while.
Maybe, but then again, they're booking him pretty strong.
Well,
they're booking them as this nerd, but then he's also being strong. It's kind of like having a parent hit you and then give you a cupcake.
Yeah, it's weird because later in the Rumble, he, you know, comes out at number 8, and he goes pretty fucking far.
Yeah, he goes to, like, the final 5, I believe.
Was it final 5?
It was final 5. It was one of the single-digit final ones.
We'll see in a little while, but, yeah, Sammy just came off as a geek, and I think he's just going to eat shit for a little while, maybe the next month, who knows. Then we had Rich Swann versus Neville for the Cruiserweight title.
Heel Neville is the goddamn greatest gift to this goddamn division that they could have ever gotten.
Really? Like, they've done nothing with the Cruiserweights since the CWC. And when Neville came back, you know, it's exciting. Like, okay, cool, that's really cool. And then he turned heel. Heel Neville's been the best part of his character since he debuted.
Heel Neville is fucking amazing. I would have children with Heel Neville. I would fuck Heel Neville.
Who was saying that he looked like a Spartan? Was that Jose?
Yeah.
He looks like a fucking Spartan. He has the face about him. He looks like a fucking jacked man. He's huge, jacked man.
He's huge, jacked, and actually, I was surprised that Rick Swann got in that much offense.
Really, I think it's. I mean, for a while, we were calling Kevin Owens the Brock Lesnar of NXT for a while, but I think we can now say that Neville is kind of the Brock Lesnar of the Cruiserweight division.
Well, even right now, Brock Lesnar isn't Brock Lesnar.
Well, but. You know what I mean, though, right? Just like that guy that, like... So, long story short, Neville won the match, and he should never fucking lose his title.
Yeah, no, he should hold this for a year.
Who would you want to see topple Neville?
No one.
No one? Okay.
No one.
Okay. Well, I mean, they're going
to maybe Rick Swann to get it back, but, like, in a while.
I don't...
Like, in a hot year.
I don't want anyone beating Neville for that title until they get this division fucking right.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I want everyone. Like, I love everyone. When we were watching the CWC, everyone was over as shit.
Yeah,
you know, I mean, you had Jack Gallagher, you had Rich Swann, you had Akira Tozawa who made his debut on Monday. Everyone was so over. Everyone was really cool. Yeah, dude, Cedric Alexander. They somehow, like, remember he had the best fucking match in the earlier rounds.
And now he's back to just being in a weird love triangle with Alicia Fox and
Alicia Fox,
and Noam Dar, who, by the way. Why? What the fuck are you guys doing with him?
I will admit, I do like his sleazy heel thing more than I like him, I guess.
I mean, it is nice, but he's way better of an athlete than that.
So I just thought it was funny. Like, the Cruiserweight match for this pay-per-view was the slowest. But I think it was kind of...
Yeah, actually it was. It was the slowest.
It was really slow. I think it was 15 minutes. And I think it was designed that way. Mm-hmm. Because you want that filler or that, you know, the slowdown match between the two big title matches.
You mean the bathroom break?
Yeah, I guess you can call it that. But I'm just watching it, and they're just doing moves. And we can see people just doing moves on the main roster, but, like, they're bigger, so it's more impressive, I guess. They're not doing anything that's setting themselves apart from... Mm-hmm. Everyone else, so why would everyone want to go see 205 live?
That's why they need to put them before Raw or before SmackDown.
I've been saying since they got that it was announced they were going to Raw that it should have been a SmackDown thing. And yeah, you're right. It is dumb that they're taping it after.
Yeah, because no one wants to stay after that.
No, and what I remember hearing was they have dark matches after 205 Live. That's like the SmackDown quote-unquote dark match main event to make you stay after.
Yeah.
But I you have to understand, like, even this let's say, like, that week of the Royal Rumble, you had a lot of hours of programming you were asking your viewers to watch. Mm-hmm. So let's break it down. For let's say you're a mega hardcore fan. They're asking you to watch 3 hours of Raw.
2 hours of SmackDown.
2 hours of SmackDown.
An hour of NXT.
NXT. An hour of the 205 Live. There's a two-hour pre-show. And then there's the four-hour show. So that's like 13 hours of programming they want you to watch in that 1 week. I've been a fan for a while. We've been almost fans for almost the same amount of time. Mm-hmm. I think you a year earlier than I have. That's way too much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's way too long.
And even like when people who watch things like Ring of Honor, maybe even New Japan, like that's way too fucking much. And I watch Ring of Honor, not religiously, but I watch it every week when I can. And it's just, it's so refreshing because it's an hour. Mm-hmm. And then you can just go about your day. I mean, it's not like 11:30 at night, but you know what I mean.
Yeah.
You can just, like, 3 hours for Raw is...
It's ridiculous.
That's a good chunk of a 24-hour day.
Yeah, really. Like, doing something for 3 hours a day, that's dedication.
Yeah, and 8 hours of which you're sleeping for those 24 hours. So. Yeah. So really, it's like 16 hours, three of which you have. They want you to watch Raw. And I think they got numbers back, and the third hour always does the worst. Mm-hmm. It's always the fucking dirt worst. And I'm not saying they should go back to 1 hour of Raw because that's, you know, but 2 hours is fine.
Yeah, no, I actually enjoy 2 hours of Raw.
Dude, 2 hours, and then you know, when I was a kid, I was excited they're going to 3 hours because that's more wrestling, because at the time I was like, I'm down. I love wrestling. Let's get to it. But right now it's oversaturated, and plus this, you know, this new internet era, everyone's watching everything.
And plus they don't have a lot of content to put out enough for 3 hours.
No, and... The story about the whole draft thing was the only thing that benefited was SmackDown because it's doing better in the ratings. It even beat Raw 1 week, which was pretty cool. But now the rosters are completely thinned out. That's why you have the same five guys fighting for the title every week or every month. And, well, even SmackDown does better stories, mm-hmm. but then you're oversaturating with pay-per-views.
Yeah, definitely. It's hard for us, especially,
mm-hmm.
to do... a podcast where we have to do now 3 pay-per-views in one podcast.
Yeah, we're taping this one on Friday, and in 2 days is the Elimination Chamber. But I don't want to get, like, behind again.
Yeah, totally.
That's what happened last time, was we were like, okay, we're going to do it after Survivor Series. And then they kept putting more and more stuff out, and we just did not have the time to get it.
Yeah, no, we didn't have the time to watch everything and then come and record it and talk about it.
No, and you have to think of the demographic. Like, what is it, like, 18 to 35?
Mm-hmm.
That's the main demographic. If you're 18 to 35, you're either... just getting into college, doing school.
Or you're an adult.
Or you're an adult and you're working all the time. And you don't want to, like... I guess it's free entertainment, but it's just... It's just too much at once, and I just wish... And they had brought it up to the point where... I think JBL was talking about it. To where... I think it's just... why would we go back to 2 hours? When... Like,
you go back to 2 hours because it's quality over quantity.
That and it's 1 hour. If they go back to 2 hours, it's 1 hour of not making money.
Hmm.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, granted, if it does like a 2.8, I mean, that's not great, but it's still people watching.
Yeah.
You know? And that's just 1 hour that they're, I don't think they're going to want to give up. Moving on, we have AJ Styles versus John Cena for the WWE Championship. I didn't take as much notes because I was just watching it. Because,
mm-hmm.
you know, AJ and Cena... I think Cena has grown on me because I remember in the beginning I loved him. You're a kid,
of course.
And then you're like, "Oh fuck, Cena!" And now I'm more appreciating him.
Yeah, same. I appreciate John to the point where he can never put on a bad match.
No,
I don't believe Cena can put on a bad match.
I think John Cena was the best part of 2015. That was a really bad year for WWE.
Mm-hmm.
But with the whole open challenge thing, you can see that Cena can be versatile with many different opponents. I think that's what they're trying to show. And with AJ, you can really do no wrong.
Oh yeah, of course.
Because he. Arguably is the greatest wrestler, you know, not just today. In the WWE, but, you know, really today.
Yeah, really. And it's just kind of hard to wear, like, you know, and I know people may say, well, you said you grew tired of Baron versus Ziggler, or you grew tired of The Miz versus Ambrose. The thing is that, like, with this feud, it's a lot like a Shawn and Bret feud, to where they go away for a while, they feud. They go away for a little bit, do their own thing, and then they feud. And you know that you can always put them together because they can always do good.
Mm-hmm. But I'm just watching it, and fucking David Otunga, like, I know he's, it's just, it's a joke to kind of like talk about him, but oh my fucking God.
I can live, I kind of love how you have here, I can live my entire life without David Otunga.
That's the first note I took on this match.
Jennifer Hudson, how did you marry him?
Are they still married?
I don't think so.
No, I'm watching this match and I'm listening to David Otunga. The only thing he brings, like, he doesn't bring anything, but the only thing he chooses to bring into this, or that he thinks, is like, look at these physiques. Oh, and then seeing, like, he lifts AJ because, you know, he's a big strong man. And then Mauro Ranallo is like, oh, look at him deadlift this man, getting Cena over. And David Otunga just goes, that's not a deadlift. And then they're quiet for a bit, and then JB goes, that's a deadlift, because somebody's screaming in his fucking ear, like, you idiot. God, this fucking guy, and, like, all I can talk about is, like, Cena's physique, you know, he's getting pumped up, and he's like, oh, if I was AJ, I wouldn't want to turn around and see that physique. I'm like, motherfucker, why the fuck is David Otunga, like, on the commentary? What could they, what were they, what's the mindset there? Like, you know what, David Otunga, he's not a good wrestler at all. Mm-hmm. He way the fuck wasn't.
Oh, yeah, no.
And why the fuck is, like, somebody thought, like, you know what, an announcer, that's where he'll shine. What's the mindset there?
I just kind of think whenever Vince made the World Bodybuilding Federation, mm-hmm. he made it too early. David Otunga could have been the flagship for that.
Maybe. He could have been the lead announcer. He could have been the fucking Joey Styles of the...
Oh my God! Look at those pecs!
How they jiggle! But no, this was a really great match. I still would argue that their SummerSlam match was better.
Yeah.
I like that one a bit more. Because at this,
the SummerSlam match felt like it had more weight to it.
Yeah, and which is weird because this is the match where Cena is tying the 16-time championship reign.
And it's weird because I feel like it's just transitional. It's just transitional.
It absolutely is because I was making a point where they didn't bring it up at all throughout the match really, because I think he's losing it at the Elimination Chamber in 2 days, like yeah. 2 weeks after he won it.
Yeah, and I have a pretty good idea on who's going to lose it to, but I'll bring that up later.
Yeah, and so, but you got to admit, dude, like, I think Roman Reigns did one good thing. He made it cool to cheer John Cena again. When
yeah, he
won, the fucking place went fucking crazy.
Yeah, like, all haters and all, they all came together and said, we don't like John, but we can respect him now.
Yeah, and you think this would be the one match where, you know, always tying Ric Flair's championship, like, boo the fucker. But no, everyone was just like, fuck but, yeah. No.
And also, they kind of muted it. Because of the fact, like, he's going to be a transitional champion. Mm. Also, I don't think Ric Flair was exactly a 16-time champion. I think that's just kind of fabricated a little bit in kayfabe.
Yeah, where Kane is, like, 7'4", quote-unquote, yeah. Or something.
The Big Show's 700 pounds.
Yeah. That actually may have been true at one point. Have you seen him lately?
Oh, he's lean
all
as
those,
fuck.
All those gym selfies?
Dude, those abs could kill me. Just one abdominal muscle.
Yeah.
Punch me the fuck out.
Good for him. Fucking, if he's looking good, man, if he can go longer, that's cool. He can show off these, because they're bringing in a lot of big guys. That was the whole point of this Rumble.
Mm-hmm.
Big guy mania.
Big guy mania.
If there was ever going to be a guy that can show him, like, you can be a big guy and work, I'd want it to be Big Show.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe even Mark Henry, because we'll get there in a bit. So then we have the official Royal Rumble match for 2017.
Oh boy.
No, coming into it, it was exciting. Mm-hmm. Because this was the first year, I think, like, 2 or 3 years where we'd had no fucking clue.
No idea.
Who was going to win this fucking thing. So number one comes out, and it's Big Cass with Enzo Amore.
And they cut too long of a goddamn promo.
They did their entire shtick. The entire fucking thing. And I'm looking. They have not moved a single fucking foot.
Like, move down, closer to the ring.
Down that. I think the official length was 65 yards. For the ramp.
Jesus.
They have not moved a fucking foot. They're still in the entryway doing their whole fucking thing. I'm like, move your shit. Nope. They did their whole fucking thing. And I kind of don't get their home, like, not hometown promos, but, like, we're in Texas. This is cool. For anyone who's not in Texas,
they don't give a fuck.
This is really just annoying. And I think that's why I'm kind of losing my love for Enzo and Cass, because it's just, I'm never where they are, where they're like, fuck yeah, this place is cool.
No, see, my love is still there, just I don't know what they're doing. I don't know what they're doing at all.
I don't know, but Vince saw a big guy. I'm like, I want you, and then he had to get the Enzo Amore DLC with it. Number two is Chris Jericho.
Thank God.
Did he come in number two last year?
He comes in at number two a lot, actually.
I thought he did that last year as well. But anyway, they were just kind of killing time until number three. But my thing is, like, Big Cass, if you want to get a good sense of, you know, the audience for WWE nowadays, is Big Cass, he does a stinger splash on the, you know, Chris Jericho in the corner. Mm-hmm. And he's a big fucking dude, so it should be like, holy shit, that's pretty impressive. No one cared. They just wanted to chant shit.
No one gave a shit. Single shit.
Nah. Then, remember number three last year? Motherfucking AJ Styles.
That is a fucking pop. That is a number three.
That's a good fucking number three. That's a good surprise entrant if you didn't, you know, if you didn't watch that video where he said I'm being the Royal Rumble.
Because, you know, WWE, we like surprise entrances.
But instead, we have
Kalisto. Kalisto. Everyone's favorite lucha thing.
And it was at this point when I realized, like, holy shit, that's a fucking long rampway. Then they're killing time until number four, Mojo Rawley. The audience, like, because they're excited, like, they don't know, they're kind of like 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and then Mojo Rawley's music plays, and you get that sort of, like, ah, reaction.
Like, ah, shit.
Not even a boo.
It's kind of like opening a gift on Christmas, and you're like, oh, gross, sucks.
Yeah, like, ah, fuck, seriously. Number five comes out as Jack Gallagher, which is fucking surprising. I was really not expecting any of these cruiserweights to come in.
Yeah, but also, I enjoyed his whole umbrella shtick. Just my thing is that he didn't use it practically. Like, he jumped from the top rope at one point and he had the umbrella open.
Mm-hmm.
What is your plan?
The plan was they wanted him to look like Mary Poppins, kind of floating down gently.
Oh, I get it. He's British.
That's his thing.
If that hasn't been beaten into your head enough.
Speaking of the whole British thing, that's how his feud with Neville is starting. Because he shames the British people. So they're fighting over...
Oh, yeah, that's right, because Neville's Scottish, huh? Or Irish. No,
he's British.
He's British? Well, fuck me.
Yeah. Come on, now they did an entire video thing for him when he's still in NXT, I think.
Oh, I was about to say, did it happen in 205 Live? Because I can bet you every cent I have that no.
No, but apparently the umbrella has a name. It's called William III, because he's British.
Of course.
He does the whole umbrella crotch thing with Chris Jericho.
Which was actually kind of nice.
I liked it. It was funny. Number six is Mark Henry got a bit of a pop.
Because Texas.
I actually miss seeing Mark Henry a lot.
Yeah.
I'm learning to appreciate him more because I know his time is coming up.
Yeah.
You know, he's going to retire in a little while. And he was the first person to use the golf cart, a la WrestleMania 3.
Oh, yeah, that's right. He did use the golf cart.
And they showed him coming down partway and then cut to the people for a long while and then cut back and he was to the ring. They did that a lot, and I didn't know what the fuck that was for until after I watched the Rumble, and then I looked online, like, all these pictures of golf carts.
Well, because, like, the bigger guys can't run that fast, so...
Well, no, neither could Big Cass, but then again, he was number one. He had no one to...
Yeah, totally, so...
Anyway, so Jack Gallagher tries to do a headbutt on Mark Henry, but then he just knocks himself out. And then Mark Henry throws him through the ropes. He is not eliminated. And then Mark Henry's running wild, takes out everybody, and then Jack Gallagher comes back with the umbrella, and then just... Tosses out.
Eat shit.
He just eats shit, and then Mark Henry tosses him out, and that's when Jack Gallagher flows down like Mary Poppins. Mark Henry eliminates Jack Gallagher for our first elimination. Number seven is my main man, Braun Strowman.
Braun!
No, I actually thought this was my pick to win, honestly.
Honestly, in hindsight, I wouldn't have minded it. At the time, I would have been really pissed, but in hindsight, I wouldn't have minded Braun winning.
I sincerely thought he was going to win the Rumble. I thought when he was coming out that Roman Reigns was going to get his revenge and beat the shit out of him. The spoilers, he doesn't.
No.
Like, throughout the whole match, like, they're not even in the same spectrum of, like, time in the ring.
Yeah, no.
Or when they're in the ring. So Braun Strowman just eliminates Mojo, Big Cass, and Kalisto. He has a stare down with Mark Henry and then almost immediately just eliminates him. So that's four eliminations in his entire shtick. And then number eight comes out, as we know, as Sami Zayn. And this feud, was there ever a definitive?
Oh, hell no. It's WWE. Of course they don't.
No, I think Braun Strowman just beat him.
And then that was it. And then, like, I remember Mick Foley was like, look, you don't have to beat him in this match. You last 10 minutes with him and you're fine.
I've been thinking about that lately. That's been really with the 10-minute stipulation because Braun Strowman's been fighting everyone else, but they don't need a 10-minute stipulation.
Well, because Mick Foley cares about Sami Zayn.
He apparently doesn't give a fuck about Rollins or any of the jobbers.
Of course not. An hour. But, you know, whatever.
Yeah, nah. And apparently they've been feuding since last Rumble because I think, Strowman eliminated Zayn at the last Rumble.
Yeah, he did.
Jericho's still on the outside. He's just not doing anything.
Jericho just kind of sat back for a lot of this.
He sat back the entire pay-per-view because he was out for the entire Universal title match, which was pretty long. He was in a steel cage above the ring, just standing there. And then throughout this whole match, he's just lying down or just sitting on the outside. And the number nine was The Big Show. He also used the golf cart of victory.
Just the golf cart of victory.
And then he has a stare down with Strowman, and then he gets eliminated before even number 10 comes out.
Yeah.
He's supposed to have a match with Shaquille O'Neal at Mania. I think that's the plan.
God, why? God, why?
And they're not doing anything with him since. So why make him look so weak if he's going into that high-profile match, quote-unquote?
I have the same question about Brock and Goldberg that I'll get to later, but...
So Braun Strowman eliminates the Big Show, and then number 10...
10!
10! 10!
10! 10!
10! Ty fucking 10, Dillinger!
Ty motherfucking Dillinger!
The biggest pop in the arena, the biggest pop...
of the night.
Biggest pop of the night! We need a fucking... I wish we had a buzzer. Biggest pop of the night, and also in the living room.
Yeah.
The party, we fucking exploded, because we firmly did not believe they were going to do this.
Yeah, no, we were like, yeah, no, there's no way. And I think all of us were standing up, like, come on.
We were honestly standing up, like, 10.
And as soon as the buzzer hit and we heard his music, we were like, no fucking way.
The three biggest moments of my life, the Cubs winning the World Series, Leonardo DiCaprio winning his Oscar, and Ty Dillinger coming in at number 10. I was for certain they were going to bring him in at, like, number 11 just to fuck with everybody.
Yeah, totally, just to troll the fuck out of everyone.
Yep, and then him and Sami Zayn are beating down Braun Strowman, trying to do what they can, take out the monster, and then they do the double suplex spot during a countdown. I don't get doing spots during countdowns.
Yeah, really, because no one cares.
Because no one's caring about that. They just want to see who's coming out. And then number 11 is James Ellsworth with Carmella.
Oh boy!
And Carmella has his face all over her tights. Are they an item? Are they dating?
I don't know what it is.
Because I on screen, she's not using him, is she?
Yeah, no, she's. I don't know.
Because he's not a high profile like competitor or anything.
Maybe she's just trying to make him cool. I don't know what it is.
I don't know either. Maybe it's like You Can't Buy Me Love, where she's like she was dared to make this nerd look really cool, and then she falls in love anyway.
With that no chin.
Hey, man, he's exotic.
True. I mean, hey, if Shawn Michaels ever tries to super kick him, he has nowhere to kick.
Exactly. He's invincible. Hey, and that's what everyone does now anyway, super kicks.
Yeah, totally.
He's the most invincible wrestler today.
Just no super kicks.
No one can touch him. No one can touch him. And so she's trying to convince him to go fight Braun Strowman, but as you remember, Braun murdered this man as his first victim.
Yes.
And the road to Braun Stroneman. Senior Stroneman. And then so Ty and Zayn try to eliminate Braun Strowman as he's distracted by Ellsworth. And the number 12 comes out, and it's Dean Ambrose. He woke up from his nap.
Yeah, totally. And you know what? I'm glad he was finally able to get his revenge on Dean, on James Ellsworth. Because they kind of just buried that. And it was like, oh yeah, that's right. You fucked over Dean, like, a few months ago, right?
Well, also, how many times has Dean fucked over Ellsworth?
I mean, a lot. But still, no one gives a fuck about Ellsworth.
Well, fucking, I do. Carmella, me and Carmella are the only ones who care about James Ellsworth. Because Dean Ambrose is just a dick. He's just like, we're going to fight him. On three. We're going to go attack him. 3, 2, 1, and then he just hangs back and fucking... Ellsworth takes the fucking scariest bump I've ever fucking seen.
Just right on the neck.
Look, Braun, like, he picks him up from the chokeslam from the ring and then drops him outside on his fucking hip.
Yeah.
Like... And apparently he's fine, he's hanging out, but I'm like, this scared the fucking shit out of me. I literally jumped out of my seat, I think. So anyway, then Braun Strowman does the roar spot that big men like to do. And this is when I realized that, like, there is, like, a significant difference between, like, different intervals, obviously.
Yeah, really.
Like, they're like, oh, it's a 2-minute interval, which is different from the 1.5-minute thing they used to do back in the day.
Yeah, and then, like, some intervals are like, oh, that's 30 seconds, what the fuck are you doing? Or like, oh, that's 5 minutes, what the fuck are you doing?
Inconsistency. Why don't they just, like, ignore that, like... Just don't say a time limit.
Yeah, totally.
Just don't fucking say it if you're going to be that...
Whenever that next person wants to come in.
Mm-hmm.
Like, have them come in.
Exactly. The number 13 comes out was Baron fucking Corbin.
Thank God.
Not my main man, but I fucking love Baron Corbin. I want to get that out of the way right now. I fucking love Baron Corbin.
I will marry Baron Corbin, I swear to God.
Yeah, no, you can never marry him. He's a lone wolf.
True.
He trails his own path. And so Braun... they're all beating up on Braun Strowman, and then Braun Strowman eliminates Ty Dillinger, and then they all like immediately beat up on Braun. Sammy hits a Huluva kick, and then Baron Corbin eliminates Braun Strowman,
which was, I'm happy about. Yeah, because that book's Baron strong as fuck, actually.
It really does. And coming off that loss from Cena a while back when they were still pushing Baron for a while.
Yeah.
And he beat him clean. I'm like, well, that's shitty. And then they do this. But why do they have to eliminate Ty Dillinger right before they eliminate Braun?
Reasons. I don't fucking know.
I don't know. I maybe could have kept him in there a little longer. Jericho's still in there.
Yeah, he's still there, believe it or not.
Yeah, he's still fucking in there.
He's still hanging out.
Number 14 is Kofi Kingston. The only notes I wrote was I'm still in love with Baron Corbin. Baron Corbin is pretty fucking cool. Honestly, he can be a contender. He could be.
Fuck Kofi. I care more about Baron. I want Baron to re-enter.
Kofi does one cool thing a year.
Yeah.
And they're getting lamer each year.
Yeah, totally.
So why the fuck would I write anything about Kofi Kingston?
True.
You tell me. Anyway, but I'm saying Baron Corbin could be a top contender for the world championship. Just don't ever have him talk.
Mm-hmm.
Listen.
Listen.
I speak words.
I tell you things.
Boy. Then he just leaves.
Best promo of 2017 right there.
He's better than Kalisto, whatever the fuck that was at the draft.
Lucha thing.
I'm going to do the Lucha thing. Shit.
God damn it.
Number 15 comes out. It's The Miz with Maurice. She leaves immediately, so why the fuck even come out?
Maybe, yeah, seriously.
Is that to tempt the people that get heat on Miz? Like, ooh, are we see the beauty? Like,
ooh, maybe we'll get to see some Maurice titties. No.
No, and then she just leaves.
No. Which, by the way, my girlfriend watches Total Divas, so I have to watch that piece of shit show.
Why does she watch Total Divas?
Because she likes wrestling, but she doesn't care about, you know, wrestling.
Sure. Okay. Whatever. Okay. That's a you thing. I don't have to do with that. But that's
okay.
A you thing entirely.
Okay. She likes Bayley and she likes Total Divas.
Okay.
But actually, Maurice, really cool in person, or at least that's how she's portrayed on the show.
I'd imagine.
Yeah. But anyway, yeah, just fucking leaves her husband right there, just like later.
Well, what's she gonna do? Is she gonna fucking try to take out Baron Corbin?
Yeah, totally. Why not?
Oh yeah, why not? It's if the Rumble is no DQ, she can bring some that bug spray she got spraying Dolph Ziggler with.
I mean, she could also just bring a gun, shoot everyone.
Yeah, at what point does how far does no DQ go? Can you shoot people?
I don't see why not. Brian Pillman tried to do it.
Yeah, well, that didn't work out. I mean, Stone Cold's alive and he's not.
Moving on.
Moving on. This is when the stream started lagging
like
on the
a
network.
Motherfucker.
Because I think the WWE, like the Royal Rumble, is like a video game. If there's too many characters on screen at once, it's going to lag.
Yeah.
Because there are so many fucking dudes in this ring.
A lot of dudes.
And so it started lagging. I'm like, fuck you guys. And then Kofi. So this year, his save is he goes to the top the top turnbuckle, and then he goes on the post, and then Baron Corbin knocks his feet from under him, and then he rib cages himself, and then doesn't get eliminated. That's his big elimination save this year.
Oh boy,
they get worse every year.
Remember
dude.
When Adam Rose was a thing?
Oh yeah, remember
the Rosebuds caught him?
Yeah, no, that'd have been a cool save for Ellsworth. Like, that'd have been so fucking sweet if like throughout the whole Rumble, some guy's getting he's like crowd surfing.
Oh yeah, that'd be really cool.
Like the whole Rumble, like he's going all throughout the arena, and then he comes back.
Yeah,
that'd be fucking. You got to find some weird way to do that. Number 16 is Sheamus. He's running wild on everybody. And then at the time I counted, there were 7 men in the ring.
Mm-hmm.
Which is a lot of dudes, but not as much as they let, they allow way more later on.
Oh, yeah.
Number 17 is Big E. That's 2 members of the New Day in at once. He also uses the golf cart of victory.
Golf cart of victory, yeah.
And then he uses the lick-ass spank spot. Like, he has the Miz in a domino stretch.
Oh, yeah, and he licks his hand and just...
He does a new... Day rocks. The whole fucking thing. And I was thinking, like, it's going to be a Big E. Like, Miz, I'm gonna eat your asshole out in the middle of the ring. How about you lick my hand and spank me instead? Like, okay, I'll compromise.
I want that to be someone's finisher. Just jacking some dude off. Just like, hang on.
Well, I mean, Joey Ryan did the test of strength with his balls or whatever.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
I mean, that could be a finish. Number 18 comes out, and it's Handsome Rusev with Lana.
Handsome Ruru.
I call him... Well, everyone calls him Handsome Rusev because he's handsome.
He's a very handsome boy.
What the fuck happened to his nose?
No fucking idea. They never explained that.
I think they wait. Hold on. It says here like they that Kofi broke his nose on Raw. I think it's kayfabe kind of thing.
Yeah.
Anyway, Lana, by the way, she leaves immediately also to hang out with Maurice, presumably, to talk about how cool their husbands are, I guess. So Kofi breaks Rusev's his nose, but then when Rusev gets in, he beats the shit out of everyone except Kofi. I mean, that's not the dumbest thing that happened.
There's reasons.
That's not the dumbest thing that happened in this Rumble with somebody in their storylines. We'll see in a bit. That's, now counting, there's 9 men in this ring. Number 19 comes out, and it's Cesaro, and he's swinging everybody. He swings, and then who did he try to swing?
Sheamus.
No. Like, remember, he tried to swing one dude.
And he tried to swing one dude, and he was just fucking dizzy as fuck, so he just let him go.
No, he couldn't get one rotation in.
Mm-hmm.
I think, was that Big E?
Yeah, I think so.
So like you were saying that he's teasing to swing Sheamus.
Yeah.
Because you know they're still because earlier in the night they lost their titles to the club.
Yeah, they lost the tag titles. So
from one club to another, congratulations, guys.
Yeah, congrats.
Appreciate it.
Too sweet to you.
Too sweet to you. But Rusev breaks up that swing attempt. There's still no eliminations at 10 men.
10 damn men are in this ring. To let you know, who came out before Ty Dillinger?
Ty Dillinger came out. It was, hold on, let me check. Ty Dillinger was number 10.
10.
And number 9 was Big Show.
No one's been eliminated since the Big Show.
Holy, Braun.
Oh, sorry, Braun. Braun. And Ty. But
that's still a lot of fucking people.
That's a lot of people in the fucking ring.
And then number 20 comes out, and that's number 20. That's like 2/3 way, and it's Xavier Woods.
Cause reasons.
Let's look at this. Let's break this down. It's just and that's when I think you made the comment of this is a really vanilla Royal Rumble.
Yeah, cause it's like we're predicting everybody. Oh, the New Day's coming in. Oh, Cesaro and Sheamus are coming in. Oh, it's the Big Show. Oh, it's James Ellsworth. Oh, it's Dean Ambrose. It's like, yeah, I get it, but. Where's the surprise?
These are just dudes.
Yeah, these are just like the guys they see at school every day. It's like, okay, that's cool, but like, where's the new foreign exchange student?
Yeah, I heard he was coming through. What?
Yeah, totally.
I think the only surprise was Ty Dillinger.
Yeah.
But I think at some point it wasn't a surprise because everyone figured.
Yeah.
I think we're just surprised they actually did it. There are 11 men in the ring now. 11 fucking dudes just fucking about ruining my stream.
Because reasons.
Number 21 is Bray Wyatt, and I wrote...
My boo.
you both are a Cajun.
Yes.
From the Bayou.
But I have to say, through the last few months since the brand split, I have fucking loved Bray Wyatt. I've always liked Bray Wyatt, but I'm like, man, he's not being used right. After this event, he's being used right.
Yeah, I'm really excited. Okay, so we're going to just kind of spoil it. I think he's going to win the Elimination Chamber. I think that's
the
plan.
Oh, yeah, totally. Of course, yeah.
Unless Vince has an idea. Wait a minute. Cena is champion. Orton won the Rumble. We can make this happen, guys. Like, no. Don't fucking do that.
Guys, I found the reason to time travel. Let's just pretend like it's 2008. Bray, you're husky again.
No, just imagine like you're a fan who stopped watching in 2009 because everything's the same. And then like 8 years later, you're like, you know what? I'm going to come back. I'm going to see what's new, what's happening. I hear, like, you know, all these new guys came in. They have Samoa Joe, AJ. It's going to be fun. You watch, and it's fucking Cena is the champion, and Orton won the Rumble. You'd immediately turn back off.
Like, nope, never mind.
The more things change, the more they stay the same. But to be honest, like, the way they booked it to where you were kind of happy at the time that Orton won, but we'll get to that in a bit. But it was just cool seeing Bray come out with all the Fireflies and everything.
Yeah.
And all the men fighting among the Fireflies. That was pretty sweet. And they had a cool spot between Wyatt and Woods when they reminded us of that, when Wyatt kind of had like his hold over Xavier Woods.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He was trying to bring him into the Wyatt family. I would love to see that. I want to see Xavier Woods bring back the beard.
Oh, yeah, the beard and like the big afro poof.
Yeah, the Consequences Creed type thing.
Yeah.
It's just cool to see continuity in general. And then number 22 is fucking Apollo Crews.
Because, look, Apollo Crews, you are a beautiful chocolate man, but you are the most vanilla wrestler I've ever had the... Ugh.
Really? He really, really, really fucking is. And I remember even like in NXT, because his moveset was just kind of cool sometimes. He did like the standing moonsault, which is pretty nice. I mean, he's athletic as fuck, don't get me wrong, but it's just like he's vanilla as fuck.
Yeah, he is, honestly.
More than ice. Ice, baby.
Ding, like, ding, 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 ding. Like one time, I ate a piece of white bread with ice in the middle, and it was still more flavorful than Apollo Crews.
We can just go down the whole list of just dudes who did not have to be in this Rumble.
Yeah, seriously. Like, Xavier Woods didn't have to be in it. No. Big E didn't have to be in it.
Okay, Apollo Crews didn't have to be in it. Xavier didn't have to be in it. Biggie didn't
Kalisto
have to be in it.
Kalisto didn't have to be in it.
Kalisto didn't have to be in this Rumble. I'm just going back through the whole fucking thing. James Ellsworth, where the fuck
didn't. Oh, fuck no. Ty Dillinger even didn't have to.
He didn't have to, but it was cool to see him. Mojo Rawley.
Mojo Rawley. Fuck
probably
off.
The biggest loser in the whole fucking thing, dude.
Fuck off.
Jack Gallagher didn't have to be in it.
Big Cass even.
Like, this whole, like, first two-thirds of is just fucking dudes, or dudes fucking. That'd have been fucking more... Anyway,
are you just saying that you'd rather watch porn than watch this Rumble?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Anyway, the crowd is like, okay, so at this point, there's 13 guys in the ring. They need to start fucking getting rid of people. And then the crowd, you know, they're calling for Goldberg, because even they realize there's a lot of fucking dudes here right now. Mm-hmm. So Sheamus and Cesaro eliminate all of New Day at once. But then Sheamus tries to eliminate Cesaro. But Jericho finally fucking comes in and eliminates them both. So that's 5 eliminations, so we're down to 8, so that's
sleeping
good.
Sleeping Jericho finally awakes.
Yeah, he used the polka flute. Woke him up. So number 23 comes out, and it's Randy Orton. At least it's a dude. At least it's somebody.
At least it's somebody. And then he RKOs the fuck out of everybody, which I actually liked to see.
Yeah.
I wanted to see that.
Because memes are cool.
Yeah, memes are awesome.
Yeah, no, it's just RKO's everybody. And it's just fucking cool to see a guy that I kind of want to win still in there. Because my pick was gone pretty fucking early on.
Yeah.
Number 24 comes out and it's fucking Dolph Ziggler.
Heel Dolph Ziggler.
He's a heel now, yes.
Yes.
Can't confirm.
Yes.
So why is it when he comes in, he beats up all the heels?
Because Dolph Ziggler doesn't understand who he is or what he is.
I don't know how the fuck he did it. But in the past 2 years, Dolph has made himself look like a fucking idiot.
Yeah, seriously.
I remember in 2013? Remember how fucking over he was?
Yeah, remember when he won Money in the Bank?
And when he cashed in?
Remember the double turn? Remember?
Oh my fucking God. This guy was on top of the world. He kicked out the Authority.
Yeah,
he was
seriously.
The last man standing.
Yeah.
And then it's just, this guy's a dork, he loses now. Even as a heel, he still loses all the fucking time.
I don't understand it at all.
God, I'm over Dolph. I am over fucking Dolph Ziggler.
Dolph, I'm over you like Amy Schumer is.
Yeah, the sex was too athletic, Dolph.
Yeah, it was too athletic. And then, number 25, Mr. Luke Harper.
Well, I kind of wanted to see what they did with him in the
Yeah,
Wyatts.
I was happy to see him.
Well... The crowd is still disappointed that because it's number 25 and we still haven't gotten Taker, Lesnar, or Goldberg. And at this point, you got to realize they're saving the dudes until that last cluster at the end. And so Harper just immediately eliminates Apollo Crews since taking out that dork.
I love how they say it's the most star-studded Rumble. It's more like the star-studded
last few, like
five or six people.
Like the star-studded last fifth.
Yeah, really.
No, like the last tenth. There's 30 dudes.
Yeah,
last
seriously.
Tenth.
Yeah.
And then so they have like a stare down between all the Wyatts, and you know, you think. Harper is like, okay, he's all cool. Then he hits this fucking discus lariat on Wyatt.
And then about to put him through the sister fucking Abigail.
That was fucking crazy.
That was dope.
And then but Orton hits the RKO. I just love the whole storyline where it's Orton is the one that's still brainwashed.
Yeah, really.
Like Harper got out. I've been watching people play Resident Evil 7. Is that what it's supposed to be like at the Wyatt compound?
Maybe.
Welcome to the family, son. Is that what it's supposed to be like? Where I don't, because they're spooky too.
I feel like it's a bad version of Alexandria.
They got the spooky powers.
Yeah, spooky powers.
So fucking whatever. Anyway, so Orton hits RKO on Harper, and that's when I realized that a guy had a sign that says the Warriors blew a 3-1 lead, and that was pretty
sitting
fucking
right in the front row.
Right in the front
just
row,
kind of like how the Falcons blew a 21-3 lead.
You're welcome for that, by the way. Because here's how that happened, the whole Super Bowl thing. I was not watching the bowl because I was fucking around back here with the new microphones and everything. So I didn't watch the first third. I mean, the first three quarters. And I came out, and I was like, holy shit, they're down like, what, like, it was like 8-29 or some shit like that?
Yeah, something like that.
And then I came out, I'm like, oh man, that's really fucking shitty. Sucks to be you at the Super Bowl who lose that fucking much. And then I came out and I finished watching it. They fucking came back in the overtime and won the whole fucking thing. I'm like, I gave you that, New England. Where the fuck is my check?
Some of my friends were fucking around. They're like, watch, Tom Brady's going to come back and have the greatest victory of his whole career. And it's like, motherfucker.
Yeah, no, and that's a pretty big fucking Super Bowl comeback.
Yeah, really.
From that big of a deficit? That's pretty fucking insane.
Speaking of deficits and comebacks.
Yeah, here's Brock Lesnar at number 26.
Brock Lesnar comes through and is just like, fuck all of you.
Yeah, so the crowd was fucking hyped to finally see someone they wanted to see.
Yeah.
That was advertised. So Lesnar just eliminates just Ambrose and Dolph. Let's get these two losers out of here.
One thing I don't get is, like, so he does F5s to Miz and Orton. Mm. Where was their whole thing with SummerSlam? Why wasn't Orton like, motherfucker, like, you like, opened up my skull. Like, what's up?
I think at that he said those same words, like, oh, shit, motherfucker, you opened up my skull. Fuck that. You know what I mean? There was a fight or flight, and he flew.
He definitely flew.
He flew pretty high to the...
He flew far away.
No, he hits a German suplex to Rusev, Jericho, and Baron. He hits the F5 on Miz, and the softest F5 on Orton. Maybe that's an apology for...
Yeah, it's like, sorry.
Sorry I murdered you.
Sorry I literally made you bleed like a stuffed pig.
Yeah. Number 27 came out. Fucking Enzo Amore.
Way to troll your most loyal fans that know 27 is the best possible number to be.
I think that's the joke, because the crowd was both disappointed that it wasn't Goldberg, but they're also excited that Enzo's about to get murdered
for making us
sit through that whole fucking shit.
Feed him to the wolves.
He fed him to something, and then Lesnar just clotheslines Enzo, and he's so like somebody actually shot him, like somebody actually got that gun you were talking about and shot him.
Oh God! Oh Jesus!
And then Lesnar just fucking eliminates him because fuck that. Number 28 is finally fucking Goldberg.
Goldberg.
Goldberg. And then he spears him and eliminates him. Eliminates Lesnar.
Oh, yeah.
Like, immediately.
Immediately. Like, literally, their entire, like since in the past 10 years, the amount of match time Lesnar and Goldberg have is not the same amount of time as your average Nickelback song. How does that make you feel?
Well, it makes me feel bad because you just mentioned Nickelback, and that brought back the horrible memories of my mom taking me to concerts of Nickelback when I was a kid. Appreciate that.
Look at this photograph, and it's just like Brock Lesnar it's Brock Lesnar on the ground, like, what the fuck?
Yeah, no, and I mean, it's a cool way to get Goldberg over to the fans who might not know who he is. It's been 10 years since, or 13 years since he was there.
Oh, by the way, Goldberg is facing Kevin Owens at Fastlane for the title. So they're probably just going to put the title on Brock or Goldberg.
That match was going to main event regardless, so you don't need the title for that match.
No, you don't.
You don't need it. Like, Kevin Owens should just go in as champion and then just...
Do his thing and leave.
He can lose it there, I guess, but yeah. Come on. I mean, you don't need the fucking title. Anyway, so the Wyatts team up, which is White and Norton, and then they get double-speared, whatever, it's cool. Number 29 comes out, and it's fucking Undertaker.
Big spooky man.
And he just appeared. He was an apparition. He just appeared in the ring. And I knew he was going to do that because there's no way fucking The Undertaker was going to walk down that long-ass fucking ramp.
Honestly, Undertaker has to retire soon. Just seeing him in this match, I mean, he could still work really well. But he's obviously very physically...
old?
I was going to say, like, inept. But, I mean, like, I've always going to appreciate the work Undertaker's done. He got me into wrestling. But he didn't seem like himself in this match. He just didn't.
No, when was the last time he wrestled? Was
Leaf? It was last WrestleMania. It was the WrestleMania before that.
He didn't fight at SummerSlam?
No, he didn't.
I thought he did.
No, Taker didn't fight at SummerSlam. The last match he had was with Shane in WrestleMania.
Oh, fuck, you're right, I think. Anyway, so him and Goldberg just have a stare down. Then Goldberg eliminates Rusev and Taker eliminates Baron. Which is, you know, Baron lasted a while.
Yeah, totally.
He came in at number 13. Well, yeah, and then Goldberg spears Taker, and then he eliminates Harper. And then Taker eliminates Goldberg, which was pretty surprising.
I kind of feel like that's right.
Yeah, well, it's like a triangle. It's like a Pokemon effect.
Yeah.
Where Brock Lesnar can't beat...
Goldberg.
Goldberg can't beat Taker, and Taker can't beat Lesnar.
You're right.
It's a Pokemon effect. Who's the fire type? I'm going to give it to Goldberg. He breathes fire.
And then the water type has to be Brock.
Yeah, but he's just sweaty. He's a sweaty dude.
Yeah, true. And then... And
Taker
and,
is as frail as a leaf.
Yeah, true. At this point, Taker's as frail as that tree as I've been trying to plan for like 2 years.
How's that coming along?
Pretty shitty.
Oh, no? Yeah. Well, we're not so much in a drought, but yeah. We could use some fucking rain.
And then
Taker's fighting everybody. Can we build to this, please? Come on, let's slow it down. Let's take our time.
I hate my life, Alex.
Fuck it. Number 30 was Roman Reigns.
Motherfucker! You have got to be fucking kidding me.
That when number 30 hit, and it turned out it was Roman Reigns. the wrestling community, the wrestling world collectively got up. We flicked off our TVs and then calmly sat down. It was a silent rage. We were like that fucker who won, what was it, Tough Enough like 4 years ago? Andy, remember him? He was like silent rage.
Oh, yeah,
silent rage. That was all of us. We had a silent rage. Like, you've got to be fucking kidding me.
And just like Andy from Tough Enough, we all just went away.
We just fucking just... Well, in kayfabe, what was... Hold on. And let's say wrestling is real.
Okay.
In the real world of wrestling, what was the fucking idea? Was there a guy who was at number 30, and then when Roman was lost, like, okay, I'm taking your number? Or did they have him still at number 30 when he... If, let's say he won, he was still number 30, was going to fight himself if he won? I think Vince would love that if he just wrestled himself. Just lathering himself all over.
trying to spear himself.
Yeah, it's just... And I didn't... And this, I thought I heard bullshit chance. I rewatched it. I definitely heard bullshit chance.
And dude, there's actually supercuts everywhere of people just saying, are you fucking kidding me? Yeah, this is bullshit.
I'm telling you, TV. I remember... Did you see that one where that guy was like... He was there in the arena and everyone takes those selfies of like their reaction number 30?
Yeah.
And he's like... He's smiling and then he's like... You hear... Dun, 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 and it's just like a frown. An immediate frown. And then everyone around him is just like fucking hands on head. Losing their fucking minds because they couldn't... They've done it again.
Yep. Yep. They've done it again. And I'm like, this can't be another fucking Rumble with Roman Reigns.
And then Taker just eliminates Miz in the daintiest way, and then he eliminates Sami Zayn, and then fucking Roman Reigns eliminates Taker. That!
Because fuck John Cena versus Undertaker, we don't want that at all,
no,
Vince.
We're getting John Cena versus Taker. John Cena's a little tan here.
And he has really long hair, and he's Samoan.
And just, I mean, I wasn't expecting Balor, because I know he still has a ways to go until he comes back.
Yeah, and I was kind of expecting Joe, but eh.
And then... No, we got a Samoan named Joe. I think Vince misheard us because he's so old. But they're fucking doing Taker versus Reigns at Mania. I don't trust Reigns with Taker.
Fuck no, I don't. I wouldn't trust Roman Reigns to walk my fucking dog. I wouldn't trust him to fondle my nuts.
Was this a heel turn?
I'm through asking that. I hope it is. But at this point, it's kind of like hearing about a. It's kind of like hearing about the poutine fries at like over at McDonald's. It's like it's a rumor. You always hope it's there, but it never is.
No. And then Roman just eliminates Jericho, who decided to come back in the match, get his revenge, I guess, from that.
Reasons.
Get revenge from that. And then the last three men are Bray Wyatt, Randy Orton, and Roman Reigns. Personally, I would have loved if Bray Wyatt won. In retrospect, he probably should have.
Yeah.
Because if they're going to have that feud, fucking why not just...
Yeah, why not put the title on Randy? He stays heel, Wyatt turns face, simple as that.
Maybe, I know they love Orton, so why not have him go face, I guess, but, like, you know what I mean, like, Bray, of all these three dudes, I think Bray needs that Rumble win the most.
Oh, he definitely does. He's been jobbing for basically 3 years. He jobbed to The Rock at last WrestleMania. He's jobbed to Roman. He's jobbed to Cena. He's jobbed to so many people.
Ambrose. Fucking... Maybe even Harper, who knows?
Yeah, who knows? Get him over.
And then the family teams up on Reigns, and then he just Superman punches everybody, and then the Roman eliminates Wyatt, and then people are still fucking pissed.
I'm like, motherfucker, I never thought I'd say this, but I hope Randy wins.
Exactly. That was the point. I think that's why they put him in there, because you needed a reason for Randy to be happy that he won.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So then he goes for a spear on Orton, then Orton turns into an RKO, which admittedly was pretty cool looking.
Yeah.
And then Orton eliminates Reigns for Randy Orton to win the 2017 Royal Rumble match. Hoorah! Hooray!
Yay!
It was better than 2015.
Anything's better than 2015. AIDS is better than 2015.
Oh, that's unfortunate. Before we head out, I wanted to talk about the Seth Rollins thing.
Yeah.
So, Joe debuted the night after, just also trolling of everybody else, because fuck you, right? He debuted on Monday, the night after, and then he had a program with Seth Rollins, where you thought they were going to fight at Fastlane. And then so Joe, he hits him with the Coquina Clutch, the standing Coquina Clutch, and you know Seth is selling, he's doing his thing, you know, he's waving his legs around. But when he waved his leg around, Joe did the falling to the back, and he injured the previously injured knee that got him out of action for 8 months.
Yeah.
And so doctors say you have about 8 weeks until you can come back.
And that's literally WrestleMania.
That is literally WrestleMania. So. Let's say he's able to come back. right? Mm-hmm. Is he facing Joe or Triple H?
Triple H.
Okay. So is he ever going to get a revenge from Joe?
I think so, but later. But here's my thing. Here's a little bit of some fantasy booking. Mm-hmm. So, Rollins is injured, right, so he can't wrestle. We have Triple H come out 1 week. I've proven that I'm the game and don't fuck with me, and I can choose who I want to take under my wing and not. And then every week he keeps getting cut off. The mic keeps getting cut off. He's like, what the fuck? I signed your paychecks. Like what is this? And then after like the second or third week, we see Seth Rollins on screen. He goes, hey, Trips, it's me. So, you royally fucked up, and you're about to pay for it. And we just see him, like, destroying Triple H's office. And we see him, like, destroying Triple H's car. And this persists, like, throughout the weeks. He's, like, burning DX merch. He's burning Triple H merch. And he goes, you know what, Trips? You have taken from me what I'll never get back. Family. And relating back to the Shield. Mm-hmm. I have to pay for my sins. And you have to pay for yours. He puts down the camera, and he's in front of Triple H's house. And we see a car drive right through the front fucking door.
Didn't he threaten to murder his children?
Who, Seth Rollins?
Yeah.
Maybe.
He was talking to Stephanie, and then he was just like, what's going to happen when I come knocking on your door and your children answer? I'm like, did you just threaten to murder his daughters?
Motherfucker, what?
Like, wait, that's good. Let me get my fantasy booking real quick.
Okay.
So let's say that he can't make it to Mania. Then they save that match for SummerSlam. Because they're not going to do it in the pay-per-views before. Fuck that. They're going to do it at Battleground. So they do it at SummerSlam. So what if, and it ties everything together, what if, you know, they do the match at SummerSlam, but each month leading up, Seth has to go through one of Hunter's NXT kids. Starting with Samoa Joe.
I like that, but does he have enough time to do that with his injury?
Yeah, he can totally do that because he's coming out like right after Mania, and then if they're doing it at SummerSlam, that's 4 months in between.
Well, yeah, but if he like works at being prepared, like he'll get better literally the week of Mania, and then he's like, you know, like, and I can just imagine Trips coming out and saying, you know what, if you have the balls to do it, I'm here, impromptu match.
Well, that's my thing. I really don't think he's gonna be like we all want him to because he missed it last year.
Yeah.
But I just really don't think it's going to happen realistically. I don't think so.
Hopefully.
But like I was saying, like if he does the whole fight the NXT kids, because you know who else is coming back from injury? Finn Balor.
Finn Balor.
And Triple H, he brought me to NXT. He put me on a grand scale. He made me, he brought, like, I know, I've been Prince Devitt, but he made Finn Balor. Mm-hmm. And also, Seth, you took me out of action. You broke my arm. You cost me my title. I'm coming to kick ass. And then Finn turns heel, and that's when they do the thing they want to do with the club.
Yeah.
So they can have AJ versus Finn at some point, whatever. So they can do that, and then they can find some two other NXT dorks nobody cares about.
Like Dillinger and...
Like who or fucking even... Well, not Kevin Owens.
Mojo Rawley. No, I'm kidding.
Fucking Mojo. Jesus. He's a hype heel. Wait, he's Double H.
He's Double H.
You got to get through Double H to get the Triple H. The hype heel. But I don't know, man. We'll see where that goes. I hope he can make it, honestly, because if he doesn't, man, that's really unfortunate. That's really the worst fucking luck.
It's really shitty. Like, the worst time to have that happen.
Worst time, like, dude, like, week before fucking, you know what I mean? He'd been good for Mania. But that week, that amount of time, I don't know. But yeah, thanks for listening, everybody. I know it was a long wait. It was a long wait for us as well to try to get everything done. But, you know, one year after, we're still going strong. Be sure to check up our Twitter, everything on Facebook. Make sure to check out our Patreon to see if you're willing to donate.
Donate, because those are some dope-ass prizes.
Some pretty fucking good prizes, man.
So wait, if I donate to the own Patreon I'm on, does that mean I get an associate producer credit?
Sure, why not?
Fuck it, I'm going to give you $10,000 right now.
Fuck, you'd never see me again. This would never happen again if you gave me $10,000 right now.
The channel's done. Alex is off to Mexico. Fuck
yeah, absolutely.
It.
Hey, in a few years, New Mexico might just be Mexico.
Pretty much.
Yeah, absolutely. I wouldn't mind. Fuck it. I got some change. But yeah, thanks for listening, everybody. Really appreciate it. We'll see you next time. Bye, guys.
Laters.